I hate these gloves. I can never put them on the right time, the right way, and the right.
This looks bad. Well, I did what I wanted to do. I left them.
Like right here, normally. I should actually have my hand up. Thank you.
All right, everybody set? Places, please.
Places.
Places. Uh-oh, where's my little thing? Actors, did you check the props? Actors, did you check the props?
It must be on the prop sheet.
Black stockings.
Christmas wouldn't be Christmas without any presents. It's so dreadful to be poor. I don't think it's fair for some girls to have plenty of pretty things, and other girls nothing at all.
We have father, mother, and each other.
We haven't got father, and shall not have for a long time. Perhaps never.
You know the reason Mother proposed not having any presents this Christmas. It's going to be a long winter for everyone. She thinks we ought not to spend money for pleasure when so many men of the northern and southern armies are suffering so.
We can't do much, but we can make our little sacrifices.
And ought to do it gladly.
I'm afraid I don't.
But I don't think the little we could spend would do any good. We've each got a dollar, and the army wouldn't be helped much by giving that.
I'd planned to spend my dollar on new music.
I wanted to buy a nice box of Faber's pencils. Mother didn't say anything about our money, and she wouldn't want us to give up everything. Let us each buy something for ourselves and have a little fun. I'm sure we've worked hard enough to earn it.
I know I do. Teaching those tiresome King children all day. I'm longing to enjoy myself at home.
You don't have half a hard time as I do. How would you like to be shut up in the house with nervous, fussy Aunt Marge, who keeps calling, Josephine, where is that girl? Where is that girl? And worries you till you're ready to fly out the window.
I do think that washing dishes and keeping things tidy is the worst work in the world. My hands get so stiff that I can't play my piano.
I don't think any of you suffer as I do, for you don't have to go to school with impertinent girls who laugh at your dresses and label your father if he isn't rich.
If you mean libel, say so. And don't talk about a label as if Papa were a pickle bottle.
I know what I mean, and you needn't be satirical about it. It's proper to use good long words and improve your vocabulary.
It's vocabulary.
I said it was.
Don't you wish we had the money that Father lost when we were little? What does it mean to go on a man's bond?
It's like this. Say I owe a lot of money.
How much?
Thousands and thousands.
Well, how could you owe it when you don't own it?
That's called high finance.
It isn't honest.
The demarcation between good business ability and dishonesty is very slight.
Infinitesimal.
It's fin, infinitesimal. Mr. Bottomley was Father's best friend. He owed a lot of money and his creditors made demands on him. He took sick and Father went on his bond. In other words, guaranteed to pay his debts if he failed.
He did fail. I'm older than the rest of you, and I can remember when we had better times in this house.
They'll come again.
Oh, certainly. We're young and talented. Joe will be a great writer. Amy will be a celebrated artist. And Beth will be a famous pianist.
And you, Meg?
She'll marry and support the rest of us. I had a fun time with Aunt March today.
How? Tell us.
Well, you see, she insisted on my reading from that dreadful book Bellstrom to her. So I droned away as usual, knowing she'd soon fall asleep. So the minute her cat began to bob, I whipped out the Vicar of Wakefield from my pocket and began reading, keeping one eye on him and the other on Aunt. Well, I got to the place where they all tumble in the water, and I laughed out loud. This woke Aunt, who insisted I read a bit of the frivolous stuff.
Weren't you frightened?
Scared to death. I read my very best, though she only said, I don't understand what it's all about. Go back and read it, child.
What did you do?
Back I went and made it as interesting as I could. Once I was wicked enough to stop in the most thrilling place and say meekly, I'm afraid this tires you, ma'am. Shall I stop now?
What did she say?
She caught up the knitting which she had dropped in her lap, gave me a sharp look through her specs, and said in her short way, finish the chapter and don't be impertinent, miss.
Did she own she liked it?
Oh, bless you, no. But when I went back after my gloves, there she was, so hard at the vicar that she didn't hear me laugh as I danced a jig in the hall.
What a pleasant life she might have if she only chose.
Well, I don't envy her much in spite of her money.
Rich people have as many worries as poor ones, I guess.
That reminds me. I have something to tell. It isn't funny like Joe's story, but I thought about it all day.
Has it something to do with the case?
Yes. When I arrived, I found everyone in a flurry. One of the children had said that her elder brother had done something terrible, and his father had sent him away. I heard Mrs. King crying. Mr. King was talking very loud.
How inexplicable.
Grace and Ellen turned their faces as I passed, so they should not see how red their eyes were. I didn't ask any questions, but with all their wealth, I felt so sorry for them. I was rather glad I hadn't any wild brothers to do wicked things and disgrace the family.
Well, I think being disgraced in school is far more trying than anything incorrigible boys can do.
Meaning what?
Susie Perkins came to school today with a lovely red carnelian ring. I wanted it dreadfully and wished I were her with all my might. Well, she drew a picture of Mr. Davis with a mountainous proboscis and a hump on his back, with the words, young ladies, my eye is upon you, coming out of his mouth in a big balloon thing. Well, we were all laughing over it when suddenly his eye was upon us.
What did you do? What did he say?
Ordered Susie to bring up her slate.
The poor child, whatever did she do? She was paralyzed with fright. She went.
Well, she had nothing else to do.
What do you think he did?
Spit on the slate.
Joe!
To rub it out.
He took her by the ear. The ear, just fancy how horrid. And led her to the recitation platform. And made her stand there for half an hour, holding out the slate so everyone could see.
I'll wager you didn't envy her then.
No. I felt millions of carnelian rings couldn't have made me happy after that. Such agonizing mortification.
I saw something I liked this morning.
What was it, Jules?
Well, when I went to get some oysters for Hannah, Mr. Lawrence was in the fish shop.
Lawrence's grandfather?
Yes, he was just as grouchy as ever. But he didn't see me, I hid behind a barrel.
A barrel of trouble.
A poor woman came into the shop with a mop and a pail and asked Mr. Connor if she could do some scrubbing for a bit of fish because her children were hungry.
Did Mr. Connor give her employment?
He was in a hurry and said no rather sharply. But Mr. Lawrence hooked up a fish with the crooked end of his cane and held it out to her, saying in his gruff way, "Go along, woman, and cook it." She took the fish and ran out without having it wrapped. Oh, she did look so funny, hugging the big slippery fish and hoping that Mr. Lawrence has been in heaven much this evening.
Christopher Columbus.
Joe, don't use such slang words. Joe, don't. It's boyish.
That's why I do it.
I detest unladylike girls.
And I hate affected ninny-pinny sillies.
Birds in their nests should agree.
Really, girls, you are both to blame. You are old enough to leave off boyish tricks. It didn't matter so much when you were a little girl, but now you are so tall. And turn up your hair. You should remember, you are a young lady.
I'm not. And if turning up my hair makes me one, then I'll wear it in two little tails till I'm 20. I hate to think I have to grow up to be Miss March and be prim. It's bad enough being a girl anyway when I like boys' works and games and manners.
But your hair is so pretty, Jo.
The finest in the family.
I wish mine were as nice. I can't get over my disappointment in not being a boy. And it's worse now, for I'm dying to go fight with Father. And all I can do is sit around and knit like a pokey old woman.
Poor Jo. It's too bad, but it can't be helped. So you must be content with making your name boyish and playing brother to us girls.
As for you, Amy, you are altogether too particular and prim. Your airs are funny now, but you'll grow up an affected little goose if you don't take care. I like your nice manners and your refined way of speaking, when you don't try to use those absurd words. But those words are as bad as Joe's slang.
If Joe is a tomboy and Amy a goose, then what am I, please?
You're a dear.
And nothing else.
Just our little mouse.
You know, I wonder what could be keeping Mommy.
She'll be home soon. I think her slippers are quite worn out, don't you?
She must have a new pair.
I thought I'd get her some with my dollar.
No, I shall. I'm the oldest.
I'm the man in the family now that Father's away, and I shall provide for the slippers, for he told me to take good care of her while he was gone.
I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll buy something for Mother and not get anything for ourselves.
That's like you. Beth, what should we get?
I shall get her a pair of gloves.
A pair of gray shoes, the best to be had.
Handkerchiefs, I'll hand.
I'll get her a little bottle of Cologne des Français. She likes it, and it won't cost much. So I'll have money to buy my pencils.
Then it's settled. We'll go shopping tomorrow.
Right. There's so much to be done about the play on Christmas night. And we have to be doubly perfect, for Aunt March is coming to see how well we perform her brainchild.
Her brainchild?
Well, she did give me the plot from an old Greek story.
Yes, but you wrote it.
I hope you didn't tell her the dress rehearsal today. I did, but there isn't the slightest chance of her coming. Her leg is giving her trouble, and she's too interested in the Vicar of Wakefield. Come here and practice that faith you'd seen, Amy. You're as stiff as a poker in that.
I can't help it. I don't choose to make myself all black and blue, tumbling as flat as you do.
I could sink into a chair and be graceful.
Do it like this. Clasp your hands so, and stagger around the room crying, "Rodrigo, save me! Save me!"
was your day?
It's wonderful.
Well, dearie,
how have you got on today? Has anyone called, May?
No.
How was your cold, then?
Oh, it's much better, thank you.
Joe, you look tired to death.
I'm all right. There you are. We've all been sharing stories about our day. Share our yours.
I have a treat in store for you.
Oh, what is it?
A letter. Three cheers for Father.
Shh, quiet, all of you.
My dear wife and darling children, I know you will be pleased to hear that Mr. Lincoln has chosen Ulysses Grant to lead the Union. We are hoping this conflict between the North and the South, between brothers and fathers, will soon terminate. I've been extremely busy and am so grateful of my duties as chaplain. As you are well aware, I am too old to be chaplain, but I am doing my part and am satisfied with results. Now, for the best part of the letter. How are my little women? Give them my dear love and a kiss. Tell them I think of them by day and pray for them by night, and find my best comfort in their affections at all times. A year seems very long to wait until I see them, but remind them that while we wait, we may all work so that these hard days may not be wasted. I know they will be loving children to you and will do their duties faithfully, bravely, and so beautifully that when I come back to them, I may be ever fonder of my little women.
I am a selfish girl, but I'll truly try to be better, so he won't be ashamed of me.
We all will. I think too much of my looks, and I hate to work, but I won't anymore if I can help it.
I'll try to be what he calls a little woman and not be rough and wild.
I'll be all that Father had hoped for when the new year comes around. For we all have our part to play in the scheme of things.
I must play the part too.
You, Marmy, you're so perfect. Why did you say that?
As I sat, cutting out blue flannel jackets today, I felt anxious about Father and thought how lonely and helpless we should be if anything happened to him. An old man came in with an order for some clothes. He sat down next to me and I began to talk to him. He looked poor and tired and anxious.
What did you say to him, Marmy?
Have you sons in the army, Hattie? Four, said he. Two were killed, one is a prisoner, and I'm going to the other, who is sick in a Washington hospital. I said, you have done a great deal for your country. Not a mite more than I ought to. I'd go myself if I was any use. As I ain't, I give my boys and give them free. He spoke so cheerfully, looked so sincere, and seemed so glad to give his all, that I was ashamed. I'd given one man and thought it too much. Well, he gave four without grudging them. I had my girls at home to comfort me, and his last son was waiting miles away to say goodbye to him, perhaps. I felt so rich, so happy, thinking of my blessings, that I made him a nice bundle, gave him some money, and thanked him heartily for the lesson he had taught me. When you feel discontented, think over your blessings and be grateful.
I'm going to take that advice.
Me too. Now, girls, you promised me a dress rehearsal of the Christmas play.
We have to set the stage.
Have you much to put on?
We'll be ready in 5 minutes. Come on, ladies.
I'll get the door. How do you do, Mr. Thornton? How'd you come in?
Thank you, Miss March.
Oh, my.
I'd like you to meet my tutor, Mr. John Brooke.
Pleased to meet you, Mr. Brooke.
So nice to meet you, Mrs. March. Laura insisted that we come to see the rehearsal.
You're just in time. The girls have retired to prepare for the rehearsal.
Have you got him?
Not yet.
That end, I'll get the other.
I've had the great pleasure of knowing your daughters, and I feel my meeting you is indeed an honor, Mrs. March.
How?
You are the sort of mother I always wished to have.
What do you mean?
My mother died when I was a baby. And my dream of a mother is an exact duplicate of what your daughters express in every action and reference to you.
They are, dear girls.
Joe is the nicest.
We don't quite agree with that statement, do we, Mrs. March?
I have no choice.
I'm afraid my leaning would be toward Miss Meg.
Really? Are you ready, Marmee? The entire audience is seated.
Peanuts, popcorn, programs.
Is that you, Laurie?
Yes, and Mr. Brooke is here.
Meg, Mr. Brooke's here! Quiet. Curtain.
Hither, hither, from thy home! Alley spirit, I bid thee come. Born on roses, fed on dew. Charms and potions canst thou brew. Bring ye hither with elfin speed the fragrant filter which I need.
Hagar, hast thou prepared the potion which will free me from this fiend Rodrigo?
I am incanting the spirits now.
Dispatch with speed, for my revenge must be appeased.
Why is our revenge so great for this Rodrigo?
He is my rival for the hand of Zyra, who dwells in yon castle. I demand from you a potion to make Zyra adore me, and another to destroy Rodrigo.
I shall encant the spirits once again. Anori ori ikaru an, fillers and fires and liquors, John.
Hither I come from my airy home, afar in the silver moon. Take the magic spell and use it well, or its power will vanish soon.
Is this the potion that will bring me happiness and revenge?
Verily, tis, most honored Hugo.
Then, potion, do thy dirty work. Zyra will soon be mine, and Rodrigo's doom is sealed.
Didst bring the potion I demanded?
Verily, I didst. What dost thou ha-ha to?
To bring revenge upon his revenge.
How is it possible?
That vehement villain hath killed several of my people!
Denounce to him.
Zounds and stealth, no! If he knew, he would not come to me seeking aid.
How will you? I mean, how wilt thou avenge?
I shall thwart his plans and be revenged upon him. Come, O power of evil, come! At thy work and have it done, in the snow or in the rain, bring to Hugo every pain, refuse the good, and send the worst. Let his revenge be accursed.
That was excellent.
Meg is indeed a good actress. She can make a living at it.
No one ever makes a living out of it. All they ever get is an existence.
From what I hear, you're right.
Wasn't Jo just wonderful?
She has a spark of a genius. I don't mean in her acting. I was referring to her writing.
Did she write the play?
Oh, yes. Every Christmas, she writes another and more interesting one.
My beloved Zyra, full many a time hath the moon in its orb swung round the sun since first our love was plighted.
It seems but yester-eve we met. Jupiter was glowing in the north heavens, and to the south, Orion was wending his lonely way. Oh, woe is me, to be beloved of two men, and my choice not of my honorable sire.
Mayhaps we can win him to our side.
I fear 'tis useless. Our cause is dark.
'Tis always darkest ere the dawn breaks upon the world.
Methinks me hear me father.
Daughter?
Do not enter, sire. I am retiring. My maid hath removed my gown.
Sleep dwell upon thine eyes and love in your heart for the man of my choice, the most honorable Hugo.
Good night, sire. Didst hear? I am betrothed to Sir Hugo.
me.
There is but one solution, my love.
What is it?
Flight.
Whence?
To my baronial estates in the vastness of the Black Forest.
Where dwells the dragon?
No longer does he abide the locality.
What meanest thou?
I slew him yestereve. Out of the forest he came, demanding the blood of a nobleman. I mounted my trusted charger, Apellinon. Fire flew from the monster's mouth, and the gleam from his eyes was like the twin suns in their brilliance. He stood upon his back limbs and rose to the height of a mountain. Then he sprang. Apellinon was not to be outwitted, and he sprang to one side, and in a flash my trusty sword had entered the heart of the beast. The monster lashed from left to right, uprooting trees and leveling hills with each slash of his tail, and not until morning did his agony cease, and he lay cold in death.
My hero! My Rodrigo!
Here, I have a rope ladder to reach the tremendous height of your chamber. Thinkest thou it's possible to catch it?
Cast thou the rope, and I will catch it.
Hast thou secured it?
I come to you with great dispatch.
Let me help you, Joel.
Oh! I told you so! I told you so!
Are you all right? Of course I'm not!
Oh, how could you be hurt? I was on the bottom!
Her feelings are hurt. Now, girls, let's get the stage cleared away. Mr. Lawrence, Brooke, if you'll be so kind as to replace the sofa.
Here. You take it.
Thanks. I like the chair better than you.
I'm sorry, Amy. Please forgive me. It was my fault.
That's the way all sisterly arguments should end. I'm proud of your attitude, Amy. At last, someone in this house is developing a level head.
Aunt March, we didn't know you were here.
Did you ever appreciate my being anywhere?
Did you see the play?
I did all of it, and I would advise a deal of application and rehearsing if you intend presenting it Christmas Eve. It is in a deplorable state of imperfection.
Aunt March, this is Mr. Lawrence.
How are you, young man?
Fine. And my tutor, Mr. Brooke.
How do you do? Josephine, you must be more positive and commanding as Sir Hugo, and more tender and loving as Rodrigo. Suit your actions to your words, and you might be possible as both characters. Margaret, don't put so much character in your voice as Hagar the Witch. Amy, make fewer gestures and talk like a human being. Beth, you must study your role, child. You don't know what you are talking about.
How does it all end, Meg?
This young lady's name is Margaret. Mr. Brooke?
I'd like to hear the end too, Joel. Miss Josephine.
I'll tell you how it ends. The father interferes. The villain tries to get the hero to drink with him, but the witch has switched the drinks. And when Sir Hugo drinks, he dies. Rodrigo then asks for the hands of Zyra. Zyra informs him he is too poor to offer a diary. Rodrigo then clasps his hands. A page enters with bags of gold. Zyra is given to her lover. And all ends well.
I'll go on.
Permit me to accompany you, Miss March.
Joe, how will you manage the drinking scene when you play both Hugo and Rodrigo?
Meg plays Rodrigo in that scene.
You girls are too versatile.
It's a telegram! For you.
Get some water, Lori.
I'll get it.
Read it, Marty.
get to Washington?
I'll see what I can do.
Wait for me, Laurie.
If you don't think I'm intruding, I'll accompany you to Washington.
I couldn't ask that of you, Mr. Brooke.
I'll have Mr. Lawrence commission me to go.
Maybe he will listen to my pleading on your behalf. Me and Beth, do you think you are strong enough to fetch my small trunk?
Yes, ma'am.
Here you are. So that was your Mr. Lawrence. You might know he'd inherit the wild ways of that mother of his, the opera singer. I never blamed his father for sending him away from home under the circumstances. What was in that telegram?
Yeah, read it.
Where are my spectacles? Oh, my goodness, I have them on. War at his age. The government refuses to take him because he is too old and too sick to be a soldier. And he goes without pay to minister the gospel to the sick and dying.
A noble sacrifice.
And he sacrifices his health. Fine sacrifice that. You'll get no money of mine to go to him.
I haven't asked for any money, have I?
No, but you'll need it, won't you?
Yes.
Then why refuse mine?
Because you didn't offer any.
But I do. He's my own flesh and blood and sick among strangers. Who else should give her his comfort? How much do you need?
Why?
Don't interrupt. Oh. Seems I have no money with me. You'll have to stop on your way to station and I'll give you what is necessary. No. Amy. John, how are you advancing in your drawing?
Well,
Don't interrupt, young lady. Well, I know. I had a talk with Mr. Davies just the other day, and he thinks you have great talent. If you keep improving, I promise to send you to Europe when you are ready.
Thank you.
Ever meet the Vicar of Wakefield, Amy?
No.
You should. It's a great book.
The dear soul. Beth, will you pack a handbag for me?
Yes, ma'am.
Grandfather sent these for Mr. March.
You and Amy put them in the trunk. I'll get my belongings to pack with them.
Here, Amy, take the bottles, but be careful. They're 50 years old.
All right.
Grandfather's in to place the blankets on the bottom and the wine in the center so the bottles won't break.
Okay.
Oh, you take that end.
It's a nice hand to hold.
You really think so?
The nicest I've ever held in my life.
Oh, so then you've held hands before?
Yes, Joel's, but hers are like a boy's.
Joel always wanted to be a boy. But I think a girl should be a girl, for then she's preparing her life for motherhood and marriage.
Grandfather sent this wine for Mr. March when he began to convalesce.
Please thank him for me. Here we are, Marnie.
And we have good news. We stopped to ask Mr. Lawrence to commission me to go to Washington with you. I'm to have leave for 2 months.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Brooke.
Did Giants hitch up the Grays?
They're at the door.
Are you all packed?
Yes, I think so.
Come, Brooke, lend a hand and we'll carry it to the carriage.
I must be forgetting something. Your shoes aren't. Oh, my.
Get my bonnet, will you, Meg?
I'll get this.
Towards making Father comfortable and bringing him home.
My dear girl, where did you get it?
$25? Joe, I hope you haven't done anything rash.
No, it's mine, honest. I didn't beg, borrow, or steal it. I earned it, and I don't think you'll blame me, for I only sold what was my own.
Your hair! Your beautiful hair! Oh, Joe, how could you? Your one beauty. My dear girl, there was no need of this. She doesn't look like my Jo anymore, but I love her for it.
It doesn't affect the fate of a nation.
What made you do it?
Well, I had to do something for Father. May gave all of her quarterly salary towards the rent. I bought some dresses with mine and felt wicked. I had no idea of selling my hair at first, but I saw a sign in a barbershop window, and it came to me. All of a sudden, I had something to make money out of. So I walked in and asked them if they'd buy my hair.
I don't see how you dare do it.
The barber stared at first. He wasn't used to having girls bounce in off the streets and ask them to buy their hair. But when I told him what I wanted to sell it for, he turned to his assistant and said, please oblige this young lady.
Didn't it feel dreadful when the first cut came?
I took one last look at my hair as the man got out the shears, and that was the end of it.
Thank you, dear. Your father will be proud of the sacrifice for him. Goodbye, Meg. Be the little mother in my absence.
I will.
Children, do not grieve or fret when I am gone, or think that you can comfort yourselves by being idle. Keep busy with your work, for work is a blessed solace. And remember, whatever happens, it is God's will. And for the best, my little women.
You will say hi to Father, Charles.
Well, yeah. Don't forget
your
bar.
Don't go on to right.
Have a good time.
Bye.
Bye, children.
Goodbye.
Joe! What is it, Joe?
My hair. My hair.
Oh, darling. What's happening?
We make in the air could come true?
I create such quantities, it'd be hard to choose which I'd have.
You'd have to pick your favorite one. Which is it?
If I tell my dreams, will you tell yours?
Yes. If the girls will, too. We will.
And our sweet little invalid?
Don't joke, Laurie. I'll be well soon.
I know. I never would have said what I did.
Now, Laurie.
After I'd seen as much of the world as I'd like, I'd like to
Laurie,
settle down and...
sit still.
I'd like to settle down in Germany and become a famous musician and have all the world rush to see me. And never to be bothered by money or music, but to settle down and live where I like. That's my favorite dream. What's yours, Meg?
Oh, I should like a lovely house with all sorts of luxurious things. Nice food, pretty clothes, pleasant people,
and heaps of money.
I should manage it as I like and have plenty of servants so I never need work. But I wouldn't be idle, but do good and make everyone love me dearly.
Why don't you say you had a splendid wise husband and some angelic little children? You know your castle wouldn't be complete without.
You'd have nothing but horses and novels and yours.
Wouldn't I, though? I'd have a stable full of Arabian steeds and rooms filled with books. And I would write out a magic inkstand so that my books should be famous like Laurie's music. I want to do something wonderful, heroic for the world that won't be forgotten after I'm dead. I shall write books and become rich and famous. That is my favorite dream.
Mine is to get well, stay at home with mother and father, and help take care of the family. I only wish that we may all be well and together. Nothing else.
I have so many, but my favorite is to go to Europe and study painting and be the best artist in the whole world.
We're an ambitious set, aren't we? All want to be rich and famous. I wonder if any of us will get our dreams.
If we're alive 10 years hence, let us meet and see how many of us get our wishes.
I hope I shall have done something by then to be proud of.
Mommy says you need a motor, and when you get it, she's sure you'll work splendidly.
Do your duty, and you'll get your reward, as good as Mr. Brooke has, by being respected and loved.
What do you know about him?
Laurie. Well, only what your grandfather had told me, how he wouldn't go abroad to tutor for some nice rich people, and instead stayed home and took care of his sick sister until she died.
It's like grandfathers know all about Brooke. If I ever got my hands on him, you'll see what I'll do for Brooke.
Begin now. I'm not plaguing the life out of him.
How do you know I do?
Well, I can tell by his face when he leaves. Well, if you've been good, he walks briskly and looks satisfied. But if you plague him, he walks slowly and he looks dejected.
I didn't know he kept an account of Brooke's bad, good and bad marks on his face. I see him as he passes your window, bows and smiles, but I didn't know he got off a telegraph.
I'll go.
Father! It's Marmy with Father! Oh, my, so glad to have you. Father! Let me take your cloak.
How have you been?
It's been so long. Are you feeling better?
I missed you.
It's true.
It was very long. Joe, how are you? Meg, my darling, how you've grown. Amy, my sweetheart. And last but not least, my little mouse. So you were jealous of your father's getting ill and had to go get ill yourself.
How did you stand the trip, Mr. Brooks?
Splendidly. And your father was a brave soldier all the way. You must have a million of things to say to each other, so I'll take Glory along with me.
How are you, my boy? I didn't see you there.
I don't blame you. With such wonderful daughters to greet you. I'll see you soon, sir, and hope your health will return.
Isn't it fine to have them both back? It seems an age since you went away.
It has been a pretty long road.
But we have you back.
Oh, thank goodness.
I remember a time when this hand was so white and smooth and your first care was to keep it so. It was very pretty then, but it is much prettier to me now. I'm sure the sewing done by these pricked fingers will last a long time. So much goodwill went into the stitches.
Say something nice about Jo, Father. She's been so very, very nice to me.
In spite of the cropped head, I see a young lady. Her face is rather thin and pale with anxiety, but it has grown gentle. I know I shall miss my wild girl, but in her place I'll get a strong, tender-hearted young woman.
Thank you, Father. Now, Beth, Father.
There is so little of her, I'm afraid to say much, for fear she'll slip away altogether, though she is not as shy as she used to be. I've got you safe, my Beth, and I'll keep you so, please God. And last but not least, Amy. As you grow older, you shall mold your character as you do your little models of clay. I know I shall be proud of a daughter with the talent of making life beautiful to herself and others.
Now, girls, I think it best that we take Father back to his room.
Yes, I think that would be best.
About something.
Meg?
How quickly you guessed.
What was it?
Last summer, Meg left a pair of gloves over at the Lawrences, and only one was returned. We forgot all about it until Laurie told us that Mr. Brooke had it, that he kept it in his waistcoat pocket. And one day it fell out, and Laurie teased him about it, and Mr. Brooke owned that he liked Meg, but didn't dare say so, she being so young and he so poor.
Do you think Meg cares for him?
Oh, mercy, no. In novels, girls show love by blushing, fainting away, and growing thin. Meg does nothing of the sort. She eats, sleeps, and drinks like a sensible creature.
Then you fancy that Meg is not interested in John.
Who?
Mr. Brooke? I call him John now. We fell into it at the hospital.
Oh, I know you'll take his part and not turn him away. He's been so good to Father. And you'll let Meg marry him if she wants to.
Now, Joe, don't get angry about it. He was so open to Father. He was perfectly open about Meg, too. He told us he loved her and would earn her a comfortable home before asking her to marry him.
Just like him.
He only wanted our permission to love her and to work for her. But I would not consent to Meg's engaging herself so young.
Of course not. It would be idiotic. I knew there was mischief brewing. I felt it. Now it's worse than I imagined.
Joe, I can find you and don't want you to say anything to Meg. When I see them together, I can judge better of her feelings towards him.
Well, she'll see him in those handsome eyes, and then it'll be all up with her.
Aren't you overdoing it, Joe?
She'll go and fall in love, and that will be the end of peace and fun and cozy times together.
Not the end, Joe, dear.
Oh, I can see it all. She'll be absorbed and no good to me anymore. And Brooke will make a fortune and carry off and leave a hole in the family. Why weren't we all boys? Then there wouldn't be any such trouble.
It's natural and right. You should all go to homes of your own in time. But I want to keep my girls as long as I can. If Meg and John truly love one another, they can test their love by waiting.
Hadn't you rather have her marry a rich man?
Money is a good and useful thing, but I hope my girls never feel the need of it too bitterly, nor be tempted by too much. I know by experience how much genuine happiness can be had in a plain little home where the daily bread is earned.
I'm disappointed in Meg. I plan to have her marry Laurie and sit in the lap of luxury all her days.
I'm afraid Laurie is hardly grown up enough for Meg. Don't make plans, Joe, but let time and their own hearts make your friends.
I hate to see things going off crisscross and getting snarled up. I wish wearing flat irons on our heads would keep us from growing up. Our buds will be roses and kittens cats.
Father's asking for you, Marvin. All right. Thank you, Meg.
What is Laurie doing, pulling his hair and beating his chest for?
Showing how your John will go on. Touching, isn't it?
Don't say my John. It isn't proper or true.
Please, don't plague me, Joe.
I've told you there isn't anything to be said. We are to go on and be friendly as before. I see right through you. You're not a bit like yourself. I don't mean to plague you, but I do wish this was all settled. I hate to wait.
Well, I can't do anything until he speaks.
If he did speak, would you know what to say?
I'm not so silly and weak as you think.
I know exactly what I should say, for I plan to be prepared. Would you mind telling me what you'd say?
No, not at all.
I'm sure that my affairs will be useful to you in the future. I don't mean to have any affairs like yours. It's fun to watch other people, but I should feel like a fool doing it myself.
I think not. If you loved anyone very much and he loved you,
what will you say to John?
I shall say quite calmly and decisively, thank you, Mr. Brooke. But let us be friends as before.
That's stiff and cold enough, but I don't believe you'll ever say it. If he goes on like the rejected lovers in books, you'll give in rather than hurt his feelings.
Oh, no, I won't. I shall say it quite well, and I shall walk out of the room with dignity.
Good afternoon. I came to get my umbrella, that is, to see if your father is resting easily.
I'll go and ask him.
Mommy should like to see you. Sit down. I'll get her.
Don't go. Are you afraid of me, Margaret?
How can I be afraid of you when you've done so much for Father? I only wish I could repay you.
Shall I tell you how?
Oh, no. Please don't.
I only want to know if you care for me a little, Meg. I love you so much.
I don't know.
Please try and find out, Meg. I want to know so much. I can't go to work until I learn whether I'm to have my reward in the end or not.
I'm too young.
I'll wait. And in the meantime, you could be learning to like me. Would it be a hard lesson?
Well, not if I choose to learn it.
Please choose to learn it, Meg. I love to teach, and this is easier than Latin or Greek.
John, please go away and let me be.
Do you really mean that, Meg?
No. Yes. I don't want to be troubled about such things.
Perhaps you'll change your mind.
Jonna! Bless me, what's this? It's Father's friend. We were just merely talking, and I'm so surprised to see you.
That's evident. But what is Father's friend saying to make you look so? Well, there's mischief going on here, Margaret, and I insist upon knowing what it is.
We were just merely talking. He came to get his umbrella.
Yes, it's out here.
I understand now. Tell me, you haven't gone and accepted him, have you, child?
Hush, he'll hear you. Well, shall I call Mother?
Not yet. Something to say to you, and I must free my mind at once. Tell me, do you mean to marry this Brooke? If you do, not one penny of my money goes to you.
I shall marry whom I please, Aunt March. And you can leave your money to anyone you like.
That the way you heed my advice, miss? You'll be sorry for when you tried loving a cottage and found it a failure.
It can't be a worse one than some people find in a big house.
You ought to marry well and support your family. It's your duty to make a rich match.
Father and mother don't think so. They like John, even though he is poor.
Your parents, my dear, have no more worldly wisdom than two babies.
And I'm glad of it.
This Brooke is poor and hasn't any rich relatives, has he?
No, but he has many warm friends.
Cats live on friends. Try it sometime and you'll see how cool they'll grow. He hasn't any business, has he?
Well, not yet, but Mr. Lawrence is going to help him.
That won't last long. James Lawrence is a crotchety old fellow. What people can gain by being cross with the world is quite beyond me. People who lose their tempers cannot be respected.
We don't see our own virtues now, Aunt March.
You're right. So you intend marrying a man without money, position, or business, and going working harder than you do now, when you might be more comfortable all your days by minding me and doing better. Thought you had more sense, Margaret.
I couldn't do better if I waited half my life. John is good and wise, and he's willing to work.
Childish prut.
Everyone likes and respects him.
He knows you have rich relatives. That's the secret of his liking, I suspect.
How dare you say such a thing, Aunt March? My John wouldn't marry for money any more than I would. We are going to wait, and we are going to work. And I don't care, because I have been poor so far, and I've been happy. And he loves me, and I...
Well, then, I wash my hands of the whole affair. You are a willful child, and you have lost more than you know by this piece of folly.
Look, won't you stay and see Father? He'll be very much disappointed.
His disappointment? What's his disappointment to mine? Don't expect anything from me when you're married. Your Mr. Brooks' friends must take care of you now. Done with you forever.
I couldn't help overhearing. Thanks for defending me. For proving you do care for me a little.
Well, I didn't know how much until she abused you.
Then I mustn't go? I may stay and be happy?
Yes, John.
What's this I see?
Just what you see.
Congratulations.
You're the first one to encourage us.
You'll make the best couple in the land.
Thanks.
I knew Brooke would have it all his way.
I didn't. I'd have failed but for Aunt March.
I don't understand.
Well, I had planned to reject John.
And did.
What was your plan?
To say thank you, Mr. Brooke.
and fly out of the room.
What did you do instead?
I said yes, John, and flew into his arms.
Miss March, at last the sun has come into your family.
I suspected it, but not quite so soon. Come, dear. Your father will be pleased to hear this good news.
So, did you tell him?
Yes.
You told him no?
No, I told him yes.
Christopher Columbus! I don't approve of the match, but I'll bear it and not say a word against it. You can't know how hard it is for me to give up May.
You don't give her up. You only go halves.
It can never be the same again. I've lost my dearest friend.
You've got me anyway.
I know. You've always been such a great comfort to me, Laurie.
It's because I love you, Joel.
No, Laurie, please don't.
I will. I have to have it out, and the sooner the better for both of us.
Say what you will, then.
Joel, I've loved you ever since I've known you. But every time I try to show it, you wouldn't let me. Now I'm going to make you hear me and give me an answer, for I can't go on like this any longer.
I thought you'd understand.
I know, but girls are so... They mean yes when they mean no and drive a man half out of his mind, just for the fun of it.
I don't.
I thought you loved me, Joel, but I'm not half good enough.
Oh, you are. You're a great deal too good for me, and I'm so grateful and so proud and fond of you. I don't know why I can't love you as you want me to. I've tried, but I can't change the feeling. And it would be a lie to say I do when I don't.
Really, truly, Joel?
I don't think it's the right sort of love. I have to tell you something.
No, don't tell me. I can't bear to hear it.
Tell what?
That you love another man.
I haven't the faintest idea of loving anyone else.
But you will, and then what will become of me?
You'll fall in love with someone else, too, like a sensible boy, and forget all about this trouble.
I can't love anyone else, Joel, and I'll never forget you. Never.
Sit down and listen.
Go on.
I agreed with Marnie that you and I are not suited for each other. Our strong wills and quick tempers would make us miserable if we were ever so foolish as to...
Mary, I shall be a perfect saint and you can make of me anything you like.
No, I can't. I've tried and failed. We don't agree and never shall. So we'll be good friends the rest of our lives.
But everybody expects it of us. Grandfather has his heart set on it. Your people like it, and I can't live without you, Joel. Say you will and let's be happy.
I can't say yes truly, so I won't say it at all. You'll see that I'm right and thank me for it.
Oh, Joel.
You'll find some lovely accomplished girl who will adore you. I'm awkward and you'd be embarrassed by me. We'd quarrel. We can't even help it now, you see. And you should like elegant society and I wouldn't. And you'd hate my scribbling and I couldn't get along without it. And we'd be unhappy and wish we'd never done it and everything would be horrid.
Anything more?
I don't believe I shall ever marry. I'm happy, and I like my liberty too well to give it up for any man.
You think so now, but there will come a time when you'll care for someone, and you'll love them so much that you'll live and die for them. I know you will, Joe. It's your way, and I will have to stand by and see it.
Yes, I will die for him. If he ever comes along, it makes me love him, in spite of myself. But you must do the best you can. I'll always be fond of you, very fond indeed. But I shall never marry you. The sooner you realize that, the better for both of us.
You'll be sorry, Joel.
Where are you going?
To the devil.
What's wrong with Laurie? He was foolish enough to propose to me. And you refused? We're all too young to think of such things.
Meg has more than thought of it. I was just talking with Aunt March. She told me everything.
Did she threaten to cut her out?
It's an ill wind.
Meaning what?
Very soon. I'm to leave for Rome to study painting.
Oh, isn't that wonderful?
Doubly so.
How?
Well, Mr. Lawrence informed Aunt March that he was sending Laurie to Europe next month.
Well, you'll see a great deal of each other.
Won't you care?
No.
Joe, I have a confession to make.
Confession regarding what?
Well, Laurie told me he loved you more than me. And I did a terrible thing, Joe. I flew into a rage. I ran into the attic, to your desk. I tore your novel to shreds and threw them in the fire.
What? That little book I worked so hard on, have you really burnt it?
I didn't know.
Oh, you wicked, wicked girl. I can never write it again, and I shall never forgive you as long as I live.
Joe, what does this mean?
I'm sorry, Marnie. It's my awful temper. I try to curb it, I think I have, and then it breaks out worse than ever. What shall I do?
never get tired of trying, and never think it is impossible to conquer your fault.
Now, leave us alone, dear. We know how to navigate, don't we, my little mouse?
Yes, Father.
Come and sit here beside me and tell me about yourself since I went away.
Well, there isn't much to tell. Only that Meg, Joe, and Amy have been such attentive and devoted sisters, and that I was determined to get well.
We'll get well together. We'll make a race of it. What do you say?
Very well, Father. What is the city of Washington like?
A most beautiful place, but at present it is covered with much sorrow.
And New York?
Too massive for comprehension.
I'm going there.
Really?
Yes, I wrote to the Kirks applying for a position as tutor to their children.
Joe, you didn't. What did they say?
They wrote back saying that I could have the nights to myself to write to my heart's content.
You won't be leaving for some time, I hope.
If you object, I won't go at all.
We'll see.
I'll get it. It's the postman.
Are you comfortable there?
Yes. Much better since you've arrived.
Look, look, it's a check! Hooray, hooray, hooray!
What does this mean, Joe?
That I won the contest and that Beth will go to the seashore like the doctor ordered. Oh, won't it be fun?
It would be so selfish.
But you must go. I have my heart set upon it. That's why I tried and that's why I succeeded. She'll come back plump and rosy.
Hooray for Dr. Joe, who always cures her patients.
This check is from the paper.
Yes. The Rival Painters by Miss Josephine March. First prize in the contest, award of $100.
And my darling kept it all to herself.
I'd have lost nothing if I failed.
How did it happen?
Well, it all started when Mrs. Crocker took me to the lecture on the pyramids.
I remember.
Well, a man sat beside me with a copy of the paper, and he said one woman writer made a great deal of a good living out of her stories. When I told him I could do the same, he said, go ahead. So I took the story to his office. But I had made three tries before I succeeded in getting up the stairs.
Why?
Because there was a dentist sign adjoining the entrance with a great big pair of artificial jaws which slowly open and shut. I took the story to Mr. Davis, and this is the first I've heard from him.
It's a worthwhile reply.
Lucrative and surprising.
What's the story?
Oh, it's the usual labyrinth of love, mystery, and murder. At the end, one half of the ensemble is dead, and the other half live happily ever after.
You can do better than this, Joe. Aim at the highest in life and never mind the money.
I'll make a compromise of the two.
I think I'd like a stroll through the garden. Care to come with me, Beth?
No, I think I'm rather comfortable here.
I'll join you, Father.
All right.
Let me bundle you up. I'll help you. We won't be long, girls.
Just a breath of fresh air.
So far away from home.
Fear?
Don't be troubled by me anymore, Joe. Because it's best. Indeed it is.
Is that what made you so happy when you learned that Mother and Father were coming home? Did you feel it then and keep it to yourself?
Yes. I was so, so sad that I wasn't going to live, and I knew it. But I saw you all so well and happy and full of fun things to do when they came back. And then I was miserable, because I knew I could never be like you.
Oh, why didn't you tell me about it so I could comfort and help you? Why did you shut me out to bear it alone?
Perhaps it was wrong, but I wasn't sure. It would have been selfish of me to frighten all of you. You are all so dear and loving that I hate to leave you. I try every day to get better. I want to so much. I'm full of hope in the morning, but every evening I lose a little and I feel I shall never get it back. Life is like the tide, Joe. It can't be stopped.
Oh, I'm going to keep you in spite of everything. I will work and pray and fight against it. There must be a way. It can't be too late.
It is not for us to judge and condemn. We must leave it to God and nature, for only they can teach and strengthen our hearts and spirits for the life to come. I'm not afraid, but it seems I should be homesick for you even in heaven.
Make up your mind not to leave us. I'll have you plump and rosy again by spring.
You'll tell the others, won't you, Joe? I've heard that people who love us best are often blindest to such things. If they can't see it, you'll tell them for me. John will comfort Meg, and Laurie will have to comfort Amy. But you must stand by Mother and Father, won't you, John?
I can. I will. But I won't let you go yet.
I feel that it was never intended that I should live long.
Beth, please!
I only mean to say that I'm not like the rest of you. I never thought of what I'd do when I grew up, and I never thought about who I'd marry, or I never wanted to go away. The hard part now is leaving you.
You can't go. It won't. It's not late.
Joe, don't hope. It won't do any good, I'm certain of it. Now take me to my room.
Lean on me, Beth.
It's your part in life, Joe. Everyone's to lean on you for support.
And why not? I'm strong.
We've had happy times together, haven't we, Joe?
Yes, Beth.
And I think the tide will go out easily if you help me.
Beth is going back to her room.
She seems so weak and pale.
It frightens me, dear. But we're all in his hands. He knows best who to call to go.
Well, have you made up your plans yet?
Yes. We have decided to wait 3 years. In the meantime, I feel it is my duty to join the army.
What does Meg say to that?
Well, I agree with him. Our children may ask why their father did not do his duty for his country.
So there is to be a family. Well, well.
Army? Father? Meg?
You mean...
Yes. My baby! My...
You must go to her.
Happiness and sorrow go hand in hand.
Thank you.
look beautiful.
For my children, all home to celebrate your birthday.
How's Joe? The life in New York has been an educating one. And this gym and professor, Mr. Bear, she speaks so much about, must have given her good sound advice.
Who is this Professor Bear?
She'll tell you about him. I've invited Ralph Waldo Emerson to dinner.
Don't you fear he may consider her writings trash?
He's too great an artist to ridicule her. And besides, he has spoken highly of some of Joe's stories.
He had read them?
How thrilling! He admires her. In this day, when it is almost a sacrilege for women to write, it is doubly hard for them to secure recognition.
Do you ever suppose the day will come when we will have equal suffrage?
All advancement moves slowly. Morse was treated as an imbecile when he said the telegraph was possible. And this Mr. Bell, who claims he can send the spoken word over a wire with telephone, is in danger of being deported.
It does seem fantastic.
Progress always is, my dear.
That's what John keeps saying.
And he's right.
Mommy, we have to talk. Where is everyone?
Joe's upstairs finishing a story she must post. And Amy's away with Laurie to call on Grandfather. So we're alone. What is it, dear?
It's John.
What has he been doing?
I just don't know how to tell it.
Forget your being married. Become a child again and tell Mari your troubles. Maybe they are just as small as the ones that were so soon forgotten when you were little.
I wouldn't tell anyone but you, Mari. But I do need advice. For if John keeps going on so much longer, he may as well be widowed.
Meg, such a move about scandal.
Well, I don't care if it does. I want a divorce.
Start at the beginning.
He's away all day. And at night, when I want to see him, he is continually over at the Scott's house. It isn't fair that I should have the hardest work and never any amusement. Men are very selfish, even the best of them.
So are women. Don't blame John until you see where you are wrong yourself.
Why, Mommy? I thought you'd take my part.
So I do, as far as sympathy goes. But I think the fault is yours, Meg.
I don't see how.
Did John ever neglect you, as you call it, when you made it a point to give your society an evening? His only leisure time.
But how could I, with two babies to tend?
I think you could, and I think you ought.
Why, Mommy?
May I speak quite freely? And will you remember that it is mother who blames as well as mother who sympathizes?
I will. Speak to me as if I were little Meg again.
You've made the same mistake that most young wives make, forgotten your duty to your husband and your love for your children. Children should draw you near together, not separate you. I've seen it for some weeks now, but have not spoken, feeling it would come right in time.
Do you really think so, Mother?
John's longing for his little home. But it isn't home without you, and you are always at the nursery.
Well, oughtn't I be there?
Not all the time. Don't neglect your husband for babies. Don't shut him out of the nursery, but teach him how to help in it.
You really think so?
When you and Joe were little, I went on as you are doing. Poor father took to his books. Joe was too much for me, and I almost spoiled her with indulgence. You were poorly, and I worried about you till I fell sick myself. And then father came to the rescue and saved the day.
What do you advise?
Well, I let John have more to do with the management of Debbie. The boy needs fatherly training. Go out more and keep cheerful. For you are the sunshine maker of the family. And if you get dismal, there is no fair weather.
I think I understand.
Take an interest in whatever John likes. Talk to him and exchange ideas. Help each other in that way. Don't shut yourself up in a bandbox because you're a woman. You know what is going on in the world. Educate yourself to take part in the world's work, for it will affect you and yours.
Must I ask him about such things as business and politics?
Try it and see if he doesn't like your society better than Mrs. Scott suffers. No time is so beautiful and precious as the first years of the little lives given them to train. I'll get it.
Look how maternal you look. Let me have your hat, dear. You look so hot and tired. Oh, how sweet and innocent they look.
You should have heard them a few minutes ago.
You don't think they...
No, not that. A pin stuck Daisy and she began to yell. Demi got angry and wanted to show her he could scream her down.
Give them to me.
Don't break them.
I had the babies before you were born. Come with Grandma. I'll put you on my bed.
John, I have decided to give less of my time to the children and more to you.
You're not ill, are you, Meg?
Who do you think should be the next man for president?
Am I hearing right? Did you say whom will be the best man for president?
I think we should run Lincoln again. Of course, James Buchanan is getting a bit too old to be put up. Don't you think?
Are you sure you're feeling all right, Meg?
Oh, yes, I do. We should have Mrs. Scott and her family over to dinner some night soon. Which does she like best? Chicken or steak?
I've never really noticed.
Then we'll have both.
What's come over you, Meg?
Oh, don't worry, John. I haven't lost my senses. I just opened my heart to Mother.
She advised you to ask a lot of questions?
No, she advised me to take an interest in the things that you like. I know nothing about world subjects or politics. But if you promise to teach me, I promise to learn.
No one ever has, or ever will, learn politics, my dear. But I will teach you all I know.
Joe, how are you, James?
Oh, good to see you.
You look so good.
So do you. I love that color.
Oh, thank you.
Hello, how are you? It's so good to see you.
I heard your train was late.
Yes, a cow got on the track and refused to budge for a full hour.
How did they get her off?
Well, every passenger tried his hand on it, at it. But finally, I gave my famous imitation of a calf.
Wow.
Oh, and it either aroused some maternal instinct in her, or frightened her into moving.
So you become a great writer.
I'm afraid so.
Why that tone of voice?
They say all writers are absent-minded. Can you imagine me getting to the place where I buy Marnie a birthday present and rushing off without it?
Have you told her?
No. I missed it just after I left the station. So I wired my next-door neighbor, Professor Bear, and asked him to post it immediately. And if he, too, doesn't forget, then I should receive it by nightfall.
The New York train came in a few minutes ago. Shall I run down and see if it has arrived?
No, there's plenty of time. A nice walk after lunch might do us some good.
Knock, knock. Anyone at home?
Oh, hey! Hey! Gorgeous! Oh, this is Europe.
Oh, splendid.
So great.
Oh,
no, let me look at you. Oh, don't be jealous, Amy. You've had him for 3 years in Europe, and if you had to kiss him in all that time, I'll show you how.
Excuse, please, monsieur.
Professor Bear, what in the world are you doing here?
I was afraid you'd lose the chance to give your mother the present, and so I brought it by myself.
Oh, you darling!
Well, I have delivered the present, and I will go back now.
You'll do nothing of the sort. I want you to meet my family.
See if I can tell who they are by the descriptions you have so often expounded on.
All right.
This is the Mary's sister, Meg.
Come to meet you.
A pleasure. And your husband?
Quite right.
And you are Amy, no?
Yes.
Charmed. You have recently been in Europe.
Just returned.
But never you tell me of your brother.
I'm not her brother.
Now, from the kissing business, I interpret he is a brother.
This is Mr. Lawrence.
I'm afraid a brother's all I'll ever be to Joe.
Well, to be a brother to such a wonderful girl, it is an honor.
I put the twins to bed.
And here is the wonderful mother I have someday dreamed of knowing.
Professor Bear, Mother.
Welcome, Professor. What brings you up our way?
Well, that is Miss Josephine and mine secret.
Really? Joe has written me of your great help, Professor.
And this is the friend and confidence of the greatest mind in the world, Ralph Waldo Emerson?
Professor Bear, Father.
A pleasure.
So you're the man who was of such assistance to my Joe.
No, nothing to the assistance that Joe was to me.
Where are the twins?
Upstairs, on my bed.
Come on, Amy, let's go look at them. Don't awaken them.
I'll see that they don't.
What is the baby's name?
Daisy and Demi.
Demi? Is that right?
Yes.
Lawyer's their foster father. He wrote us from Europe asking us to name the twins Daisy and Demi.
But in French, Demi, that means half.
Lawyer can explain that later.
There won't be any later.
What do you mean?
Well, I will go back now.
No, you don't, Professor. You're here for dinner.
Is this Mr. Lawrence to dinner staying too?
Yes.
Then I go away.
You must remain. Ralph Waldo Emerson is coming to dine with us.
You must.
That is another colored horse.
And I want you to stay. You must.
But no, on second thought, I must go. I have delivered the present, and I will go back. Oh, God in heaven, what a blunder I have made.
Did you bring me a present?
I am sorry.
It was a slip of the tongue, my dear.
Oh, what a slip.
I forgot your birthday present, Marmy. And I asked the professor to bring it. And he did. Oh, I declare, any thief could walk in here without the slightest interference from this family. How are you, dear? Let me wish you a happy birthday. Here's a shawl for you to remember me by. It agrees with your age and complexion. Josephine, glad to see you back. I've read several of your articles, read everything you've ever written, and like wine, you improve with age. Well, Mr. Brooke, and how are the twins? Oh, don't answer. What does a man know about babies? And who is the stranger? Is anyone going to introduce me, or must I introduce myself? Professor Baird, this is Aunt March.
Yo has written to me of you so many times, and so pleasantly, that I know it was you when you first come in.
Josephine has always been my favorite in this family. I knew she had it in her to succeed, but had to drive it to her when she was younger. She had depended upon these indulging parents of hers. She would have been married to some local yoko and have a baby or two to interfere with her career.
Is that fair, Aunt March?
We can only wear the shoes that fit us in this life, young man. Professor, I like your looks. I've read several of your articles, but there's one thing I must set straight in your calculations before I accept you. How, when, and where did you meet Josephine?
Oh, where should I begin to start?
At the beginning.
Well, you tell them, yo.
This could take a while.
Why doesn't everyone sit down?
Oh, Professor, sit next to me.
It began like this. You are both writers, so make it short and interesting. The first day I was at the Kirks, I was descending the steps, and I saw a servant descending with a heavy bucket of coal. And then the professor appeared out of nowhere and carried the bucket for the girl.
Bully for you, Barr. A lady in distress is always appealing.
Oh.
You read that somewhere. Go on. What was your reason for helping her?
The small bag. It is too young for such heavies.
The second day I was there, I was passing the professor's room, and by merest accident, my umbrella hit against his door.
Oh, there I stood, the door open, my nightgown, a blue sock in one hand, and darning needles in the other.
I knew German gentlemen embroider, but darning sacks is another thing.
It keeps the feet warm.
Fine logic, Professor. Absolutely. The next day I came home to find the nursery in an uproar. There was the professor playing zoo with the two Kirk children, his two orphan nephews, and Tina, the child of the French woman who does the ironing.
What did you do, Joe?
Well, she joined the menagerie. I was the elephant, and she was the kangaroo.
Oh, quite to prove of your actions, Professor. Nothing pleases children half so much as to see their elders become childish. A few nights later, he asked if he could read me The Death of Wallenstein, but he was unaware that little Tina had placed a paper hat on his head.
On in the most solemn and sad part, I look up, and she is laughing at me. And so I say, Miss March, have you no respect, so that you carry on?
And then I told him about the hat.
And we laugh and laugh.
But the hat was made from the newspaper, The Weekly Volcano, the paper I sold my trashy stories to.
But I do not know this yet, and so I lambast the paper on the stories in it.
Good for you, young man. And I sing the airs in my way, forsook trash writing, turned to better things, and whatever success is mine is due to an old paper hat. Well, Professor, it seems you and I have made something of this girl.
And I hope it continues.
Did you get a good look at the hills as you came along? Why should he go gazing at the hills?
Well, I told him of their formation, and he thinks there might be ore deposits.
At one time in Germany, I taught geology.
Strange you should mention that, Professor. Emerson has often said the very same thing to me.
Ralph Waldo Emerson.
Yes.
He would be crazy enough to believe black was white.
I want to get a good look at the hills in full sunshine. Come here, Professor. I want to show you some views of the hills.
That is beautiful, but these are not hills. This is a waterfall.
It's Niagara Falls.
Let me see. Oh.
It's the view we bought on our honeymoon.
The professor isn't interested in Niagara Falls.
Yes, I am.
Then here you are.
What interest could you have in Niagara Falls?
Is not that the place where everyone goes when they get married?
No honeymoon is complete without seeing the falls.
Then I'm going there very soon.
Alone?
I hope not.
Here's the other view I mean.
Yes. Is that a church in the foreground?
The church we were married in.
Look, Father. If we don't hurry, we won't see the hills in the proper light.
I'll run over to my place and bring you back a book on the hills.
We'll go now, Professor, and get a first-hand view. I'll get your hat.
Joe, you brought the professor the wrong hat. That's mine.
Excuse, please.
Which reminds me of a poem that Emerson once wrote called The Wrong Hat. I have an original copy around here somewhere. Know where, Mother?
I think not.
Good. Come on, Professor.
I know where it is. I'll bring it immediately.
Professor, before you go, I want to show you the pictures of the children when they were little.
He doesn't have any interest in children.
Yes, I do. On Phil.
I'll be right back.
Remember me telling you about how we used to play postbox when we were little?
For hours you have me laughing with these stories.
Well, the box is still out in the tree. We can go take a look. Come on.
Here we are, Professor. Prepare for a treat. Look, it's in Emerson's own handwriting.
The future will make this very valuable. In your will, you should put it.
10 verses of humor.
And the last is the funniest.
Maybe you should read that first.
Come and sit here beside me, Professor, while I read to you.
Father, the light is fading in the hills, and it will take an hour to read that.
I read correctly, dear, not slowly.
Now prepare for a treat. Father is the funniest reader you've ever listened to.
You can take that two ways.
There once was an old man, very rosy and fat, who continually wore a high beaver hat.
Wait till you hear to finish.
And there was an old maid, very thin and prim, who is casting amorous glances at him.
This'll kill you. See the old man and the fat fellow.
Here you are, Professor.
Oh, excuse, please. Well, later, we will all laugh together.
Come here, Professor. I want to show you these pictures.
Have you a little picture of Yo? I mean, a picture of Yo when she was little.
Yes. There she is, when she was 3.
She has not changed much.
I have too.
Oh, you grow up, but not out.
Out where?
The face out. Is this you, Mrs. Marsh? You are very beautiful now. More beautiful, though.
She's very pretty then, but she is also beautiful now.
But I do not know her then, so she is more beautiful to me now.
Oh, and this is Meg, and this is Amy.
And who is this angelic child?
Our Beth.
You always tell me often of her, how you all love her, and the devotion she gives you until the end.
Yes.
Now, Mother.
Miss Josephine, I am sorry.
It wasn't your fault.
I always hate tears. Come, Professor. I'll show you all the works we have from Emerson, and I'll read you the rest of the poem. I can see you laughing for months over it.
Joel,
glad I found you alone.
It's the first time I have been in hours.
Did you want to be alone?
Yes, alone with someone.
The professor?
My family seems to think that because he doesn't speak our language too well, he needs entertaining.
Joe, I have a great surprise for you. I'm no longer a single man.
What, you've gone and got married? Mercy on us, what dreadful thing will you do next?
A characteristic, but not exactly a complimentary congratulation.
Come on, get up off your knees and tell me about it. Fess up. You haven't even told me who you've married yet.
Can't you guess?
Not Amy.
What an excellent guesser you are.
Really, my heartiest congratulations.
Don't I look like a married man and the head of a family?
Not a bit, never will. You've grown bigger and bonnier, but you're still the same as ever.
No, really, Joel. You ought to treat me with more respect.
How can I, when the merest idea of you settled down and married is so funny I can hardly believe it.
Amy and I agree that I should be the one to tell you.
Well, you ruined your story by beginning at the wrong end. Come on, tell me how it happened.
We planned to come home with the Carrolls a month ago, but they changed their minds.
You mean she changed their minds?
She has English notions about chaperones, so we decided, let's get married. Then we could do as we like.
Why didn't you write to tell us?
We wanted to surprise you.
Well, you succeeded.
Joe, I have one thing to tell you, and then we'll put it by forever. As I wrote you my letters, I could never stop loving you. But Amy had been so good to me.
The love altered, didn't it?
You and Amy have changed places in my heart. That is all. It was meant to be and would have come about naturally if I would have waited as you tried to make me. But I could never be patient.
I told you that once.
I was a headstrong boy then, and it took a hard lesson to show you my mistake, for it was, Joel.
I knew it.
Upon my word, I was so tumbled in my mind at one time that I didn't know which I loved more, you or Amy. But when I saw her in Switzerland, everything seemed to change.
We got in our right places, didn't we?
Yes, and I can honestly say I love sister Joel and wife Amy both dearly. Oh, Joel, all my wildest dreams can't compare to the way I feel now.
Love is a wonderful feeling, Laurie, and it makes things right with the world. I know that now. Don't you think we should tell the others?
A capital idea.
Marvy! Father!
Mr. and Mrs. Brooke!
Do you want Amy?
Yes.
What is it, Joe?
Where's the professor?
What's up?
Amy, would you come over here, please?
Boris has some interesting news for you.
I'd like you all to meet my wife.
Congratulations.
Welcome to the family.
Amy, I never saw you as radiant and happy.
Why
didn't married
you tell
life
us?
Has agreed with you, dear. Why didn't you tell us?
We wanted to surprise you.
Isn't that fantastic? Who rules?
I do.
I let her think so. It pleases her.
That's one way to put it.
By and by, we take turns, for marriage has one's right and doubles one's duties.
If ever I should live to see you a henpecked husband.
Amy is too well-bred for that, and I'm not the sort of person to submit to it. But we respect ourselves far too much to tyrannize or quarrel.
Didn't I say that once?
I know I did.
Yes, sir, my wife and I.
Excuse, please, sir. Is this lady your wife?
Yes, sir, my wife and I.
My heartiest congratulations. Why did not you tell me this?
I didn't know it before.
We wanted to surprise you.
Those kind of surprises is either welcome or disastrous.
Quite right, Professor.
You must show us everything that you got. Oh, your love and your fancy French things I bought. I adore this new cute lacy fluffy.
Come, John.
What did you bring, Laurie?
Loads and loads of things.
Not cute, lacy, fluffy, I hope.
Certainly not.
Father.
I'd like to stay here and talk with the professor for a moment.
Maybe he'd prefer a younger company.
I would not call Mr. March so.
See?
But you always enjoy looking at women's dresses.
What? Oh, that's right. Especially when they're so soft and beautiful and when worn by you.
Did you want to see the dresses too?
Rather, I would say some things to you.
Won't you sit down?
I have to say this very quickly.
They won't be back for a long time.
Why are you so sure?
A house fell on them.
What house falls?
You wouldn't understand.
A more American slang, eh?
You told me you liked it.
When you said it.
Thank you.
Miss Josephine, I have something very serious to say to you. I am going far away.
Where?
A moment, please. The name of the place, it escapes me. Yes, Ohio.
What are you going to do there?
Teach German.
But you're doing that with great success in New York.
But in Ohio, I will have a chair on the university. I will be one of the faculty.
When do you expect to leave?
As soon as I pack, when I go back.
Sorry. She'll miss you very much.
We have become good friends, no?
Yes, and friendship is a gift too.
Hearts, dearest. Why do you cry?
Because you're going away.
Oh, God in hell, this is too good.
Did I cry or that you're going away?
Both.
Oh.
Miss Josephine, I have nothing but love to give you. I came here to see if you could care for me among your people and friends. I had to be sure I was not wrong.
And you found? Go on.
We have come to the place, the moment.
Yes, yes, the place, the moment.
The wonderful moment, which bestows youth on the old, beauty on the plain, wealth on the poor.
And gives human hearts a taste of heaven. Yes, Frederick?
No one speaks my name such since Nana dies.
So you've loved another?
I give my first love to her.
Who is she?
Nana? Mine sister.
Oh, your sister!
Then you will accept the heart of a poor professor?
Of course.
And we will live and teach together and be happy?
Yes.
I knew it!
Christopher Columbus! Well, I'll see you have no interest in the hills now.
Welcome to the family.
My son.
God, I'm a mother's kiss. I am one of the family.
Now we can really celebrate the birthday. Marmy, into the chair. I'll get the crown.
What is the meaning of all this?
Oh, it's an old custom. Every time on our birthday, we sit in this chair. We also put on a crown.
Hey, queen of queens, eh?
Just a fancy I invented when they were little, to please my little women.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Marnie. Happy birthday to you.
The Salento man left before Father came on, and certainly before. And that's fine with the stereoscope? Okay, good. Perfect. Thank you very much. Okay, into the house, please, everybody.
Are they still taping this?
Go away!
I don't want you anymore.
No, I do.
I had to get you back for holding me back.
Chris, we need, as soon as the play's over, we need work guys.